I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. I've been washed in the fountain, cleansed by His blood. Join heirs with Jesus as we travel this side. For I'm part of the family of for me and for our family. But
As we were there, I was intrigued by something and I enjoyed something. My wife and I stayed in his home. And we were, after the funeral service, which I was a part of, there was something that was very unique. And what it was is I noticed how that my grandfather had prepared things and got everything in order for the end of his life. Being here in California, I've seen where people have just, maybe just anywhere, but someone dies or somebody passes away, it's like, everything, the family's trying to figure out what they're going to do and how they're going to handle it and how the thing's going to be paid for and who's going to pay the bills and what are we going to do and how is that going to be taken care of. Some things intrigued me about that, how he tried to take care of every aspect of his life. I don't know how many policies he had, but I think he had 8 or 9 life insurance policies from just a smaller amount to some larger amounts. They were in a folder, organized, ready, and prepared so that when he passed away, it could be taken care of. I noticed how that he had no debt. All of his debt was taken care of. He had no debt at all. His home, his cars, everything he had was paid for and taken care of. Interesting story, my uncle teaches Sunday school at another Baptist church in town there in Jackson, Tennessee, my mom's brother, not on the other side of the family, came to visit my grandfather, and he said to him, hey, good to see you, Ben, I just want to come see you and visit with you. Everybody knew he was going to die, he had cancer. And he said, he was kind of not with it, a little bit in the last few days, and he perked up, and he said, hey, Robert, does so-and-so still go to your Sunday school class? He said, yes. Nice. Could you tell her to get my taxes done before I die? Get this handled? He said, I don't want you to be a burden on my family. He said, yes, I'll tell her. And he told her, and she got it done. I noticed how he had those trusts all set up and the will all set up. Notice how he had the funeral picked out and taken care of and who was going to speak. And I noticed how he had the casket picked out, which is interesting, but he did. I can even go further. I mean, he's a little bit, maybe he was a little OCD, He had all his shirts dry cleaned, ready to give to be in order to give out. He didn't want anybody to have anything messed up. Suits were in order. His life was in order, and I know we're talking about his life and his physical abilities, but his spiritual life was in order. He was ready to meet Jesus Christ. Every Sunday he woke up as early as I don't know what time he got up, but he'd wake up early and he'd listen to Charles Stanley because he couldn't get out of the house. Listen to him preach. A few months ago, I was able to go back and visit with him for just a brief amount of time, and I was able to spend a few days with him. I think it was 3 days, and I think y'all remember when that happened, Pastor. You remember that when that occurred? And I remember one of the things he said to me is he said, I just want to double check a few things with you, Kirk. He said, I wasn't perfect in my life, but I know that I got saved, and I remember when I got saved, and I remember I got baptized in a creek. That's what he told me. I got baptized in a creek, and I said, but I want to make sure I'm going to be in heaven. And I told him, I said, you trusted Christ as your personal Savior? Yes, I did. And I said, well, according to the Word of God, in the Bible, you'll be in heaven with Jesus Christ. He said, I know that. He said, you're a preacher. I just want to double check. I talked with him about his life, his salvation, and obviously the assurance of his salvation. When you look in your Bible and you look at this scriptures about Abraham, there's a few things about Abraham that are very interesting. We see, of course, that Jesus, near the end of his life, he had everything prepared and ready. He often related that to his disciples and those that were following him. He tried to prepare them mentally hey, I'm gonna be gone, I'm gonna be going to the cross, I'm gonna die. And many of them, I think Peter even rebuked him for that, is that right? Peter rebuked Jesus for saying that he's gonna die. And they couldn't understand. In hindsight, we look back and say, how could they not understand? But I think if you're in the midst of it, you can see how they didn't understand. Because they believed that Jesus Christ not only was a spiritual salvation, but a nation salvation. They believed that Jesus was going to lead them against Rome and give them victory and free the nation state of Israel. They had a complete misunderstanding. But Jesus was preparing his people, and he prepared for the end. And even on the cross, one of the sayings of Jesus, one of the seven sayings, Jesus said, it is, anybody want to finish it? He said, it is finished. Relaying that he had done the work that God had sent him to do. If you know God's will, you can do it. And the naysayers, God bless them. Anytime you move forward in your life, somebody's not going to like it. I can give you examples. If you get a better job, the people that you used to work with, now that you're making more than, they'll be upset. Some of them. Anybody with me? You get a new car and the neighbor's like, well, how do you afford that new car? Right? When you move forward and you're doing something for God, there's going to be somebody that don't like it. God bless them. Anyway, I just love everybody. All right.
All right.
But God called Abraham, and I love the story of Abraham because Abraham simply followed. He had not been without mistakes. I'm not going to address the mistakes of Abraham or even the sins of Abraham. And he did some very odd things, and I don't want to go into it today, but we understand more than the sins of Abraham, we had a more gracious God. And God still loved Abraham. Is that right, church?
Amen.
Now we come to the death of Abraham. We see that there are those who are near to his death. And they observe, and we observe by these scriptures, that Abraham is getting his house in order. We see that he was very thoughtful and very careful. We see that he made the promised son an heir. If you read it there, he specifically noted that Isaac was the promised son, and he didn't want any disillusionment about that. He wanted to make sure and everyone know that Isaac was the promised son. The reason why, by the way, it was noted, Sarah, when she married Abraham, that was one of the conditions of her marriage by her family. If you want to study that out, very interesting. I'm just saying. He divided the portions of everything that he had. We read that. He gave, of course, the most of it to Isaac, but he did divide gifts to Ishmael, and then he sent him away. And by the way, he sent him away far away. Why would you go to this place? He sent him away from Isaac so they wouldn't have that intention. And then he gave money to this second wife that he had. I believe her name was Keturah, who had married in his older age. But he was very thoughtful. Even to this Ishmael, who was kind of a stain on the life of Abraham, that whole situation. But Abraham dealt justly with his children. I wanted to say this. This is not part of my sermon, but I did note this and I wanted to address it. I believe in California that we could do funerals in a great way. And I wanted to say to the church, I believe that funerals are important. I believe it's a special time. And I think that we should all learn, and I'm preaching to myself from the scriptures here, that we could all learn to be prepared for funerals better. This isn't part of my sermon, but I'm just going to give it to you. It needs to be addressed. We should prepare for the future and prepare our families for the future. And I'd like to see us do that better. Set our life in order and care for those who are attending. I said something at my grandfather's funeral. You can't tell about how great someone is in an hour in a message in a sermon at a funeral, right? How many of you have known somebody that was great, a great person, and you went to their home and you loved? Now, a funeral doesn't do it justice. Is that agreed? I mean, 30 minutes of talking at a church. But I'm going to tell you what does speak to the person. The people who attend the service speak to the kind of person who is gone. That's the true testimony. Just letting you know. Abraham lived 175 years. And although he had lived a full life and sought to live for God, his body did still die. Did you know that you can live for God and do right? And you're still going to die? Well, I'm telling you that. So some of you are laughing at me, but there's some young people who don't know that. But you figure it out pretty quick. I meet people all the time, and I talk to them about their future, about their life, and just to say, if you can offend people to say, you know that someday we're all going to die? I tell them that now. I don't say, if you died today. I say, do you know that someday we will all die? Did you know that someday, I hate to tell you this, we will all die? You 18-year-olds in here, you are not bulletproof. You're not as strong as you used to be. Hey, I remember, I'm 42, I'm getting old. I remember when I was like, I thought no one could beat me in a foot race. I was the fastest ever. I was back in a while ago, right? Back in the day. Hey, right. About 5 years ago, we had a foot race, all the youth. They never beat me. I beat them all every time. No worries, no stress.
Yeah.
We would have a foot race. I beat them every time. About 5 years ago, I was running as fast as I could, and they started going by me. I remember, I'm like, what's the problem here? What's going on right now? I'm not beating them this time. And what happened is, I'm getting old. You got to say, you're not that old. Let me tell you, I'm older than I was. We see Abraham, although he did live for God, have a heart for God, and followed God, he still died at 175 years old. The Bible says he gave up the ghost. I love that. It's almost like a surrender. He gave it up. He was fully committed to God and resigned to death that when it was going to come. By the way, that's a great way to go.
Right.
I've seen the lost, the unsaved, the non-believers, Pastor Rick, where they will go in and they'll fight with everything they got to keep this body that is just a shell of a life because they're so afraid of what that next step is.
Right.
Abraham didn't fear because he fully trusted in his great God and he resigned himself. I'm ready to meet the Lord God above.
Yes.
Now, I'm not ready to go right this second, but I'm prepared.
All right. That's it.
If that makes sense to you. Notice he gave up the ghost. The Bible says that he died in a good old age. What does that mean? I love that. It was a good old age. That means he lived the full life. The length of his life was long. Now, many don't ever have that opportunity, but I love that he does. He became weary of this life, and he decided, I've lived long enough, and I'm ready to go and meet the Lord.